morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Can you hear me okay?
Yep.
Loud enough?
Yep.
Awesome. God bless you. Hope you have a great Christmas. Me and my daughter went to see my dad. Came back yesterday. I'm glad she drove. I could nap that way. That was good. We have a special guest, our grandchildren, Emma and Wyatt, are here. So welcome them. So welcome to you all. It's the last day of the year. Today's Bible story is really awesome about Jesus and Simeon. I can't wait to get into that. So it's going to be a great day. So we have these beautiful poinsettias. You want to grab one and take one home? Emma, you want one? Okay. Please take them home. And then, so the 3 days of prayer starts Tuesday. You probably got a brochure. If you didn't, I'll get you one. And then Thursday is our prayer service at 6:30 here. On the 21st is our annual congregational meeting. After worship, maybe starting at 10:30. I feel like it's a very important time again this year. Maybe a new season of ministry. I know God has been talking to me a lot about some things. So please be in prayer about the meetings. Be in prayer about what God might be doing in 2024. There's no Sunday school today. And that's all I have for announcements, unless Lisa has one.
Did you show the card?
Oh. So Lisa.
And you,
Lisa. And these awesome cards. I think you got them in the mailbox. Invitation cards.
We ran out of our old ones, so we're refreshed.
They're really cool. They're really, really cool, I think. You should have samples in your box to pass up to invite people to church. We also got a newsletter from the Root Gate that I almost forgot about. I'll try and get this on PDF so I can share it with everybody. Really awesome stuff in here about what is happening in Mexico and how we get a support, how we support this ministry. It's amazing what God does here. It's amazing what God does in this church. Yeah, that's all I have for announcements. Let's greet each other with the peace of Christ.
Thank you.
turn give us to share the shining realm of God. Amen. Let us approach our Father. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God.
Father, all powerful and ever living God, we do well always and everywhere to give you thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. In the wonder of the incarnation, your eternal word has brought to the eyes of faith a new and radiant vision of your glory. In him we see our God made visible, and set our heart up in love of the God we cannot see. Amen.
Amen. With this new and radiant vision of God's glory, let us approach the throne of God's everlasting kingdom. Let us pray. O God,
in the beginning you spoke, and creation was born, the object of your loving care. In the fullness of time you spoke, and the Word became flesh, Jesus, gift of your love. We wonder at the miracle of creation. We stand in awe before the mystery of the incarnation. Forgive us, earthbound creatures, healed in faith and empty of hope, lacking love. This year, let the miracle and mystery of Christmas happen for us again. We wait upon you with ready hearts, O God. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. From the fullness of time had come, God sent his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, in order to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption as children. This is the grace of God that has appeared, bringing salvation to all. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. In Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Jesus Christ, our Lord, for your great salvation. Amen.
The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned.
Jesus Christ is our life and light. In his name and in his power, let us worship our Lord God.
Amen. We pray together now in the name of Jesus.
O Christ, prophesy of your coming, the poor longs to see you, the heavens celebrating your birth, the apostles, the martyrs, and the faithful down through the ages, communicate the song of the angels. Your church praises you with every living language, for she has seen your salvation. Son of God, humble yourself and became a servant, raising us up to share in your glory. We were in darkness, and you have given us light and strength, peace and joy. Lead us according to your loving will. Make us a people who follow you in holiness. Give us generous hearts to hear your word, and produce in us abundant faith through the power of your Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Let's recite the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
It is time for our scripture reading.
Morning.
Good morning.
The first reading is Psalms 111. It will be read responsibly. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart, in the company of the upright, in the congregation.
Bring the works of the Lord, blessing all who delight in them.
Full of splendor and majesty is the work, and the righteous endures forever.
He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered.
Lord is gracious and merciful.
He provides food for those who fear him. He remembers his covenant forever.
He has shown his people the power of his works and given them the inheritance of the nations.
The works of his hands are faithful and just. All his precepts are trustworthy.
They are established forever and ever to be performed with faithfulness and righteousness.
He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding.
His praise endures forever.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the reading of the gospel, which is Luke 22 through 40. Jesus presented to the temple, and when the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it was written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens a womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer sacrifices according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devoted, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him, and it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of law, he took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, that you have prepared in the presence of all people, a light of revelation to the Gentiles, and for glory to your people, Israel. And his father and mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, Behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rise of many in Israel, and for the sign that is opposed, and a sword will pierce through your own soul also. So that thoughts for many hearts may be revealed. And there was a prophetess, Anne, and the daughter of Phanuel, the tribe of Asher, was an advanced in years, having lived with her husband 7 years when she was a virgin, and then as a widow until she was 84. She did not depart from the temple, worshiping with fasting and prayer night and day. And at the very hour, she began to give thanks to God and to speak of him to all who were waiting for the redemption of Jesus. They returned to Nazareth. And when they had performed everything according to the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their hometown Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom and the favor of God who was upon him. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Do you have any children today? For a message or a teaching? Would you like to hear a message or a teaching? Would you like to hear a teaching about Jesus? You want to sit right here between the poinsettias? You'll sit right there. Right on the step. Right here. Perfect. Welcome to Hope, Minnesota. You like it so far?
Tell us who they are.
So we have our grandchildren, Wyatt and Emma. Can you wave? Hi, everybody. Can you say hi? You can't hide. So last Sunday, we celebrated Christmas, the birth of Jesus. You know about that story when Jesus was born? Jesus was a baby, right? And today we're going to talk about bringing Jesus to the temple to bring him to God. Can you believe that? Jesus, the Son of God, being brought to the temple and being given to God. Can you believe that story? Isn't that amazing? The Son of God being brought to God in the temple. Wow, that's a lot of stuff going on there. You ever think about those things? You ever think about Jesus? Do you? You know how much he loves you? You know how much? Two of them. Yeah. A whole lot, right? To listen to a very important story in the life of Jesus. It's really awesome. His parents brought him, right? Joseph and Mary. You know who that is? Joseph and Mary. So think about what Jesus did for us, right? Think about what Jesus did for us and how much he loves you. Do you know how much he loves you? Do you know? Remember that, okay? Your promise? Your promise? Huh? You may take a seat. Thank you for coming up, and God bless you. Dr. Luke is quite the author, a great storyteller. And I love today's text about Jesus being brought to the temple. You know, Luke, the first two chapters of Luke is quite Old Testament. There's a lot of temple going on, a lot of people in the spirit, a lot of devout people praising God and worshiping God and serving God in the temple. So this story is about Jesus being brought before the Lord. It's amazing to me, this story. We'll start in verse 22 of chapter 2. And when the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, they brought Jesus up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. So Luke's big idea in this verse is that the parents follow the law. Joseph and Mary follow the law of the Lord. And this purification, so people debate about what this purification is all about. But I think there's two things that are happening. So they were required of devout parents. So the redemption of the firstborn and the purification of the mother after childbirth. Verse 23. As it was written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord. So this is a reminder of the Exodus. The firstborn child was dedicated to the Lord. Exodus 13:2 says this, "Set apart to me, says the Lord, every firstborn male." Now Jesus is being set apart to God. So every male that opens the womb has a sacred purpose, is a gift from the Lord, and this gift is presented back to the Lord. But then the law says the father redeems the child from the Lord by paying, I think it was 5 shekels. It's amazing how all that is working in the life of Jesus. Verse 24, and to offer a sacrifice to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or 2 young pigeons. So this offering of a pair of doves or 2 young pigeons, I think it speaks of the humble roots of Jesus. Mary and Joseph couldn't afford the expense of a lamb. So the law allowed the poor to bring turtle doves or pigeons. So it's just amazing how the law of the Lord is still in place. Jesus came to earth, but the law of the Lord still has purpose. And it was fulfilled in the life of Jesus. All these actions taken by Joseph and Mary, they fulfill the law, what the law asks of the people. It's a fulfillment of all the law in these 3 verses. So So Jesus, in the first chapter, Jesus is called Great, will be called the Son of Most High. The Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. He will reign over the house of Jacob. His kingdom will have no end. In chapter 2, Luke says, he is our Savior, Christ the Lord. But yet, he was born of a woman under the law. The Son of God, who is great, is born under the law. That's amazing to me. It feels a little frightening to me, but really, really amazing. Really amazing. Verse 25. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. So I don't hear much law in this verse. It feels to me like he's righteous by the word of the Lord. He's righteous, he's devout, he takes hold of the scriptures. He takes hold of God's promises. He's waiting for the consolation. So this consolation, God had promised to bring consolation or comfort to Israel in the time of the end. So this consolation is a promise. It's not a law, it's a promise. Simeon is waiting for this promise. He is righteous. He takes a hold, and he's holding on to the word of God, the promises of God. I love more and more just sitting with a verse and just letting it sit and just hearing all that it has to say. So this consolation is not just about comfort or comforting. It is, but it's more. There also seems to be maybe some regret for maybe being sorry for something that has happened, or maybe something is not quite right or disturbed or out of order. So this consolation begins to put things in order. It can also mean to be encouraged or lifted up. There's a lot there. Do you sense some consolation coming into your life? I think it's powerful, another gift of the Lord. It's more than comfort, it's an ordering, it's an encouragement, it's being lifted up to see some new visions maybe in this church. Verse 26. And it had been revealed to Simeon by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. So it was spoken to Simeon by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he saw the Lord's Messiah. That's a promise. That's a promise. Verses 27 and 28. And Simeon came in the spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, Simeon took him up in his arms and blessed God and said, so the spirit is coming into the temple, and Jesus is coming into the temple, and the law of the Lord is bringing Mary and Joseph into the temple. So I hear whispers of Ezekiel when God returns to the temple. And Simeon is praising Yahweh at this time. So this birth of a child, this fulfillment of God's promises, the consolation of Israel and us, and the coming of the Messiah are all occasions for praising God. No doubt about that. No doubt. Verse 29, this is what Simeon said, Lord, now you're letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. So the servant word, people have a hard time with this because the real word is actually slave. But for a Jew, this word slave didn't connote drudgery, but it was an honor or a privilege to be a slave of the Lord, to be in service to the Lord. He talks about being departing in peace, so sometimes the Jewish people might express just being willing to die after they experience a huge blessing from God. And this according to your word just means God will meet his promises. You're now letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. I love this, how Simeon held fast to the gospel according to what was written. And he is now receiving the gift of a painless, blameless, and peaceful death, and a good defense before the dread and terrible day of the Lord. This is the spirit, of verse 29. And he is going to his reward. It's just a beautiful text, verse 29. Verse 30, he continues, "For my eyes have seen your salvation that you have prepared in the presence of all peoples, to see Jesus, the Messiah, is to see God's salvation for all peoples, Jewish and Gentile." And this salvation is the victory of God, victory over all things. Jesus fought a battle on the cross and won. Salvation is God's victory for us. And salvation is the gospel of the kingdom word. The gospel of the kingdom. 32. "And a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." A light for revelation. This light shows the way of salvation. It shows the path of salvation for the Gentiles. A light for the glory. This light shows the glory of God in the coming of Jesus to the people of Israel. It's a multi-nation exodus. Exodus is salvation. Multi-nation exodus. I've been hearing this person say how the Exodus was amazing, how God split the waters, they walked through a dry land, but the next Exodus is coming, it's going to be even more jaw-dropping, even more amazing. This can include all nations. We're going to walk through whatever God prepares for us. Can you imagine that? What might that be? What might that Exodus event be for us? I can't wait to see it. I also hear Isaiah in this verse, 49:6. "I will make you a light to the nations, so you can bring my deliverance to the remote regions of the earth." Bring my deliverance to the remote regions of the earth. Verse 33, "And his father and his mother marveled at what Simeon said about Jesus." They've been marveling for a while now. The birth story, now the dedication at the temple, things that are being spoken about Jesus from the angels, from Simeon. They're just marveling. They're wondering, they're meditating about all these things. I like how Luke, he seems to be saying the father and mother were in unity. They were in unity of the amazement of all these things that were being said about Jesus. Beautiful picture. Verse 34, "And Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, 'Behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel for a sign that is opposed. So this phrase, falling and rising of many, it feels like Jesus is going to bring division in the nations. Some will be judged, will fall, some will be blessed, will be rising because of how they respond to him. Here's a first hint that Jesus' coming will be accompanied with some difficulties. Difficulties. I also hear Isaiah in this verse, Isaiah 8:14-15, he will become a sanctuary, but a stone that makes a person trip, a rock that makes one stumble. Many will stumble over the stone and the rock and will fall and be seriously injured and will be ensnared and captured. Simeon continues, and a sword that will pierce through your own soul, he's talking to Mary, so that thoughts from many hearts will be revealed. So this sword, it will pierce Mary's own life. It will pierce our own life. And this, the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed. It feels like upon when this piercing happens to us, it's going to be our how we respond to that will indicate where our heart is. And I can't help but think about the cross that will pierce Mary's heart and pierces our heart. I don't think it's just the cross he's talking about, but I sure hear that in this. In this verse, someone says quite a bit, you know, what happens when life smacks up against us? You know, what spills out? What's spilling out? What's going to be revealed from your heart when those hard things come? I think about that all the time. So then Anna shows up and she also blesses the family. I mean, just amazing how Luke writes his story. If you have time, read chapter 1 and chapter 2 of Luke. It's just beautiful. Beautiful writing by Luke. So it ends with verse 40. And this child Jesus grew and became strong, filled with wisdom. And the favor of God was upon him. The favor of God was upon him. And that favor never left. So like I encouraged you last week to meditate on the birth story, I think this scripture is inviting us to reflect on this. You know, all the temple language and the ritual language is kind of losing its grip, I feel like, in society. But I think it still has some value for us to think about those rituals and those traditions and the law of the Lord. How Jesus, the Son of God, the Almighty, was brought before the Lord. Man, that's heavy. There's some power in that scripture. There's some power as we just meditate and think. And if you meditate and think and pray together and just talk about the law of the Lord and all these regulations that were done by Joseph and Mary, I just have to believe God's divine presence will appear. And I have a hunch you're probably going to see it. I just have a hunch. Wherever there are two, they are not without God. Wherever there are two. So the challenge for us, I think, for us modern Christians, is to find, you know, rituals, you know, to celebrate the presence of God in the ordinary. You know, greet the morning with gratitude. Thank you, Jesus. This is the day the Lord has made. I was walking down the hallway, and I heard this woman singing, "This is the day the Lord has made. This is the day the Lord." And I looked in there, it was Bev. It was Beverly. "This is the day the Lord has made." You know, to celebrate food and family and friendship, have meals together, pray before the meal, you know, seeing the beauty of a family, the beauty of a child, just meditating and thinking about the beauty that a child brings to our life. You know, rites of passage, like a driver's license for a teenager, they're not to be restrictive, these rituals. They're to celebrate the goodness of God and the life of God and the mystery of God. And when you add words to the ritual, they can be powerful. They can be powerful. When you speak during prayer or during an exchange of God's word or a rites of passage event, when you speak into that, I think God hears commitment. I think love is spoken. I think promises are given. And all these things, the ritual, the speaking, I think God works through those things. I kind of want to gain that back, taking time for ritual. So meditate on this scripture, meditate on this story of Simeon holding up Jesus and praising God. Salvation has come. Salvation has come. Let's pray. Father God, you're a mighty God, you're a holy God, you're an amazing God. How you do all these things, Father God. Your text is beautiful. Every verse says so much, Father God. Thank you for blessing us with this text today. Thank you for the dedication of Simeon in the temple. Thank you for your law that brought the parents and Jesus and His Holy Spirit into the temple. Thank you for being here, Father God. Thank you for your presence in this place. Thank you for gathering us to worship you, Father God. Thank you for your love and your commitment to us. Speak to us, Father. Speak to us, because we are listening. We do hear you, Father God. Speak to us your life. Speak to us your love. Bind us together around Jesus Christ. Help us to celebrate Jesus Christ. Help us to celebrate His birth, His coming to us. And He remains here with us today. I hope we all can feel that today. I hope we all can feel the presence of God in this place. I hope I can encourage you and strengthen you, even heal you and raise you up. Thank you, Father God, for your mighty work of salvation, your victory. You fight for us every day. Thank you, Father. We bless you, we praise you. We love you and we need you desperately, Father God. We pray all these things in your Son's holy, marvelous name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.
Jesus came into this world under the law, how his first entering the temple answered prophecy for Simeon and Anna, and through them they prophesied out to us, blessing us with God's word, telling us that Jesus will bless all nations and pierce our very souls. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we look toward you, our hope, our peace, and our comfort in this new year. As we enter into the unknown of the coming year, we ask for your guidance and wisdom. Illuminate our path with your light so that we may walk in your ways and make choices that align with your will. Help us to seek first your kingdom and trust that all other things will be added on to us. Empower us to live by faith, free of fear, generous, and full of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all who are in need, for the spiritually lost, the fearful, the confused, and the ill, that the Lord will keep them safe. For those who suffer from depression and low self-esteem. For those who see no future for themselves. For those who think they are never good enough in their own eyes or in the eyes of God. For those whose lives have been touched by tragedy and guilt, that they may accept God's grace. Lord, in your mercy. Let us pray with confidence to Father, Lord of heaven and earth. Lord, we come to you for rest, renewal, and for the strength that to do what you would have us do. Hear us now as we pray for all those in need. Lord, we ask that you refresh and heal with your living water everyone burdened with suffering and sorrow. For those who are grieving, Dave and Chris Jensen in the passing of Dave's father, Merrill Jensen. For Michelle and John Engelson in the passing of Michelle's mom, Dee Dee Hilger. For Jacqueline and Jared Skalicki in the passing of Jacqueline's mom, Ruth Melcher. For Beverly Meixner and her children, Mark, Marsha, and Mavis, and all their family and friends. For Randy and Lisa Borchard, family and friends. Lord, in your mercy. For those who are recovering from healing from surgery, John Engelson. Those who are working through the challenging process of outpatient rehab, JF Fever. And for those experiencing health concerns, Don Redoux, Darla's father, Carol Wilker, Mary Arfman, Kelly Sauls, Crystal Gallagher, and Lisa Dirks. Touch each person with your healing hands, your healing balm of compassion. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for those who are in need of continued healing and wholeness. Bobby Thompson, Gary Schwartz, Velma Sakonic, Don Engelson, Jean and Audrey Larson, Sylvia Smuland, Leroy Dirks, Beth Meixner, Cheryl Harlicker, Andrea Thompson, Doug Dirks, Millie and Joel Gill. Lord, in your mercy. We lift up those serving in the marketplace, Lord. Father, we ask for your divine peace, comfort, wisdom, and your divine creativity to flow into each of us as we live out your will at work and out in our communities. Keep our eyes and hearts fixed on you in the busyness of our day and the busyness of the new year. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who we serve at Laundry Love. We lift them to you, Lord. Show them your love, Lord. Teach us to serve each person well in truth and compassionate love. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for those who we have a ministry partnership with, the LCMC, Pastor Bob Nkanka of the Congo, Pastor Stephen Hammer of Estonia, Pastor Enrique Estrada of Monterrey, Mexico, Blessman International. Protect them against the rulers, against the powers, against the world rulers of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavens. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the country of Ukraine and for the work of the Spiritual Orphans Network. Lord, in your mercy. Prayers for all pastors and their spouses serving in God's churches, especially for Pastor Scott as he leads us into the new year. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we cry out to you now for those who we mention out loud or in the silence of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we lift all these prayers up to you in your Son's holy and precious name, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us join together in praying the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. As recipients of our abundant life in Christ, we now offer our gifts to God.
Thank you.
bring us near, draw us to your side. O Lord, give us your peace. O Lord, give us your hope. O Lord, give us your joy.
God is with us. Thanks be to God.